Then the situation changes and the K5 traffic emission already makes 27%.
What is this surface area? This
surface area, surface area concentration of the surface area of the body.
По поверхности концентрации распределения вот 27% приходится на автомобильные выбросы и на 49% на вторичные промышленные выбросы и на 24% на рециклирование.
And if you would come to this actually shows that not the mass Well, let's go further. So the size distribution at the receptor site is typically this type of curve when you look at the mass distribution. So we have the nucleation mode, the particles are formed, then we have kind of accumulation, and then you have a coarse mode, and typically coarse mode is by resuspension, like traffic low way of particles.
Здесь типичное распределение частиц по размерам. Два пика соответствуют аккумуляции моде и моде грубодисперсных частиц 10 микрометров.
So the surface area changes, so the finer particles become more and more important.
Для случая распределения частиц по площади поверхности немного меняется. Видно, что больше щитков частиц с определенной поверхностью в области малых частиц, где работает нуклеация.
So if the surface area would be a biological active metric, then of course it's better to measure the surface area instead of the mass. And typically the ultrafine particles become a significant source of the surface area concentration in the air.
Ну и видно, что из этих двух кривых, что более важно в области высокодисперсных анатомий, более важно измерять общую площадь поверхности. Она оказывает большее влияние, нежели площадь поверхности грубодисперсных частиц.
And if you look at the nucleation mode, if you look at the number concentration, then the ultrafine particles are the dominant sources.
И если анализировать числовую концентрацию частиц, то также в области высокодисперсных частиц максимальная концентрация числовая наблюдается.
So why are we looking at ultrafine particles? Because of the specific toxicity that people believe are associated to them. And this is first of all a quite efficient lung deposition. A slow removal of the particles from the lung.
Почему важно изучать биологическое влияние частиц высокодисперсных? Это связано с высоким эффективностью осаждения в легких, медленной очисткой в легких, и связано с тем, что большое число частиц и больше в области легких оказываются задетыми этими частицами.
Since they come in high number and when they are deposited in the deep lung, of course many lung cells are affected by them.
То есть, ну, это уже я вам сказал, то большее число участков легких оказываются задеты этими частицами.
They have a high surface area, so if there is some catalytical reaction, then of course the surface area is dominant.
И в связи с высокой площадью поверхности суммарной повышается возможность различных критических реакций.
And when they are very, very small, many people have discussed the possibility of migration of these particles through the epithelial layer and getting systemically availability. That means they enter the blood circulation and end up
и в связи с малым размером высокодисперсных частиц, ультрафайн патриклос, они могут проходить через эпителиальный слой. Это, видимо, слой поверхности в легких, да? Сквозь это и могут смешиваться с кровью.
Yeah, this again shows the deposition efficiency of particles or the deposition fraction, and it shows that beyond the left vertical line, there is a quite substantial deposition of particles all over the respiratory tract, not only in the alveolar region, but also in the trachea and bronchial region and the nase and the pharynx. This is due by the increasing diffusion of these small particles.
Ну, здесь показаны примеры углубления, которые доходят, соответствуют осаждению в различных частях дыхательных путей. Трахеобронхиальная зона, альвеолная зона, носовая и так далее.
So, these are some measurements carried out in Munich, and they show clearly that there is a particle size dependent removal even in the upper airways. Normally, the upper airways must say that particle removal is one day or so, but as the particles become smaller, like in the red square, which are ultrafine particles, then the clearance after 24 hours, almost 95% is still remaining, unlike rather big particles, let's say 6 microns, where everything is gone within 24 hours. So, even in the trachea and bronchial airway system, we have increased residence times for ultrafine particles.
Ну, здесь показано время жизни щитки в бронхиальных путях. Оно достаточно значительное, и видно, что в области малых размеров оно больше, чем в области больших размеров. Это особенно вот, ну, для области высокодисперсных частиц.
So, and there are other biological experiments that show that not the mass, but the surface area is the best descriptor for toxicity. So these are neutrophils and the bronchial alveolar lavage of fluid, so this is fluid from the lung when people get out, and they can become cell counts of cells indicating inflammation, and you can see that these increase in indicators is well correlated with the surface area that's brought into the lung. These are the same particles, but just different surface areas, and as the surface area increases, then the toxicity indicator increases.
Ну, здесь приведены снимки частиц разных размеров, и говорится о том, что воспаление легких, которое может быть вызвано частицами, оно вот коррелируется с общей площадью поверхности.
This is another example. This is oxidative potential. So we can just
that's another example showing that the surface area is important. Также окислительная способность легких, материала легких, обусловлены, зависит от общей площади поверхности.
This
растворимость.
This nice picture shows that the combination of surface area and particle size. So this is quite an interesting experiments that has been carried out a couple of years ago. For example, what the people did, they had the metric carbon particles. They made a tracer on it, technetium, and they could obtain radiological imaging from the technetium, which is a short-lived isotope. And as you can see here, you see immediately after an hour or so a wide distribution of technetium in the entire body, as you can see. It's gone everywhere.
Здесь показано вот снимки распределения веществ растворимых веществ в легких.
But what was the case here? They did not carry out the experiment properly, or they did not prepare the stuff properly, so the technetium was leaching and had some solubility. It did not stick firmly to the metric carbon particles.
На первом рисунке введенному человеку частицу углерода ультрафайн, то есть ультра дисперсные, личные технециумы радиоактивные. И создатели эксперимента не учли, что технеция может открепляться и утекать, скажем так, в другие ткани. И вот сейчас вот будет объяснение, что случилось дальше.
And then they redid the experiments by fixing the technetium to the better fixing to the of the technetium to the to the to the electric carbon particles, and so you can see that now the system this is after another time, and you can see the accumulation of the technetium in the bladder and whatever it is in some interior in the body. But if you do the experiment right and have non-leaching technetium, then you see a completely different system. So the technetium, it stays in the lung, and there is only very very little systemic availability of the lung, so the translocation is quite minor. So it says that especially for ultrafine surface area and solubility is an important point, as well as particle size.
Немножко по-другому нас. Это был ингаляционный эксперимент, то есть человек вдыхал частицы угля вот этого ультрадисперсного меченой технеции. Но чем у них получилась вот картинка, как на втором рисунки, то есть технеции везде. А потом они поняли, что это просто технеция у них открывался от частицы, на них путешествовал самостоятельно уже по телу. Они переделали, закрепили более сильно, скажем так, на этом углероде, и уже получили нормальное изображение, когда большинство в легких и часть еще попадает в щитовидные железы, а вот, например, в мочевом пузыре, как вот на втором первом рисунке, там уже ничего нет. Это вот свидетельство растворимости, важности растворимости частиц и зависимость от транслокации в организме, зависимость
от этого. Okay, let me now come back to the more physical problems or physical description of nanoparticles. And as has been mentioned previously and in our discussion, nanoparticles very seldomly come alone as single nanoparticles. Mainly, particularly at workplaces and at emissions, they come as agglomerates. So the definitions are that we have singlets, which are the very few single nanoparticles.
Но типичными являются для первичных частиц одиночные наночастицы.
And then we have the primary particle sizes. The primary particles, these are the basic entity of the connecting group. This is, for example, here in this case, 10 to 15 nanometer primary particle size, although the agglomerate has the size of 100 nanometers.
Первичные частицы представляют собой связанную группу частиц.
And then there is the term aggregate. And the aggregates, these are a group of primary particles that are connected by chemical and sinter bonds, so that are very, very strong bonds that cannot be destroyed very easily or almost impossible to destroy them. These are aggregates.
Группы первичных частиц образуют агрегаты с сильными химическими связями.
And then we have agglomerates, so when these aggregates start to meet each other and then are only held together by weak van der Waals forces or electrical forces, then we are called these structures we are called agglomerates.
Агломераторы сохраняются вместе за счет вандервальсовских сил.
So, the size characterization, I can go through this very quickly. There are different, you can imagine it's very difficult to address or associate the particle size to the size of the structure shown here. And so there are different options to do this. First of all is the volume equivalent diameter, so that's the diameter of the sphere which has the same volume as the agglomerate.
Для характеристики размера агломератов вводится понятие эквивалентного объема.
Then we have the aerodynamic diameter, which is the diameter of the unit density sphere with the same setting velocity.
Который соответствует скорости осаждения сферы единичного радиуса.
And then we have the mobility diameter, which is nothing else but the balance between air resistance and diffusion, and it is the diameter with the same diffusion properties as the same air resistance as the sphere with the same air resistance.
И диаметр мобильности, который выражается через баланс силы сопротивления воздуха и броновскую силу.
Okay, then we have the optical diameter, which is defined by the interactions with electromagnetic radiation.
Есть же также понятие оптического диаметра, связанное с взаимодействием с излучаемым диаметром.
But for looking at nanoparticle populations, primarily the mobility diameter is used and the aerodynamic
diameter. Используется aerodynamic diameter in mobility.
Okay, but there may be a big difference between aerodynamic diameter and mobility diameter. The major reason is the entrance of the density into the aerodynamic diameter, which is not the case for the mobility diameter. This is very nicely shown in this graph here. This shows the mobility spectrum of the particle number concentration, red curve, as a function of mobility diameter for diesel soot. So these red curves are very typical for diesel emissions.
Здесь приведены кривые распределения частиц как аэродинамичным диаметром и как по мобилити диаметру для сажи выхлопных газов.
And this is related to particles that look like ones in the TM picture.
Здесь показаны рисунок этой частицы.
And what is also shown here is the mass distribution as a function of the aerodynamic diameter. So the aerodynamic diameter is measured using an impactor and measured the mass distribution.
И показано распределение частиц, измеренных с помощью импактора.
This is kind of strange because one would believe the mass distribution to be further right as opposed to the number distribution. But the reason is the size dependence of the density of the agglomerates.
Но массовое распределение красным, оно чуть-чуть двинуто правее. Это опять связано с тем, что более плотные частицы больших размеров дадут более большую массу.
Opposite.
This is opposite.
Now it's opposite. And what happened here? There is a TM picture missing. Sorry. What happened here? This is again the same mobility distribution, but now the mass distribution changed dramatically. So it was very much. So this is what you normally expect from compact particles. So the mass distribution peaking a larger diameter than the mass. And the reason is here we had compactified the agglomerates, and the density increased, and we had no size dependence of the density anymore. This just should show you that you must be very careful in using different methods to compare them, because the structure can still have a significant influence in your measurement results.
Вот здесь эти распределения в две разные стороны сдвинулись для частиц вот ультрафайн патриклс, и они наоборот массово находятся в виде еще числовой, да? И поэтому надо при измерении каких-то высокоэкспертных частиц этот момент учитывать.
So here is another system or another experiment that can deliver you some very important information on agglomerates. And I think also from a biological point of view, it is would be important to know whether the agglomerates are bound strongly together. If they do this, then there is probably also no de-agglomeration in the land. But if the agglomerates are only held together by weak forces, like van der Waals forces or electrical forces, then there is a chance when they are deposited in the land that they may de-agglomerate and become smaller.
Очень важно для частиц, которые представляют свои агломераты, знать, как долго они будут сохраняться как агломераты за счет воздействия электрических сил или сил ван дер Вальса, или они дальше будут разламываться.
And here it is shown in experiments where people looked at the de-agglomeration of possibilities of nanoparticle agglomerates, and you see here. These particles can be de-agglomerated, and although these velocities are rather high, if they were to be chemically bound, there would have been no way to take them apart. So this is a simple method, look at it, to get some information on the forces between the individual particles.
This is gas flow.
This is gas flow.
Разламывание агломераторов, она связана со скоростью потока аэрозольного, и видно здесь, вот, что с ростом скорости течения, скорости газа, агломераторы будут разделяться.
Actually, in last week's conference on aerosol technology in Karlsruhe, there was a whole session devoted to de-agglomeration of particles.
Ну, на последней конференции в Карлсруе была отдельная секция, посвященная деагломерации.
So if you look at the particle properties that are important, single particle properties, then it is the mobility diameter, the surface area as we have seen, the solubility, the primary particle diameter, and the bond strength between the primary particles and the rigidity of the particle.
Таким образом, для низкодисперсных частиц важными характеристиками являются диаметр мобильности, общая площадь поверхности, растворимость, диаметр первичной частицы и сила связи между первичной частицей и первичной частицей.
So, how are ultrafine particles being formed? The formation route for anthropogenic processes is actually always the same. They are mainly made by gas-to-particle conversion. Not get them simply by grinding processes or by weak suspension, mainly by gas particle conversion. So you have aerosol precursors, and then you have different steps. So the gases are nucleated, so you form nucleated particles, very small one, which is called nucleation mode, and then you can have coagulation and surface growth, depending on the material properties, you get completely different structures, maybe spheres or maybe agglomerates or aggregates. It's very complicated.
В результате антропогенных выбросов аэрозольных образование высокодисперсных частиц проходит несколько стадий. Это возможно взаимодействие газов, газ particle. То есть образование частиц в результате газовых реакций. Также может быть испарение жидких частиц или образование твердых частиц. Дальше образованные кластеры они могут вступать, происходить процесс нуклеации. Вот, и дальше коагуляция и поверхностный рост.
So, an example where this happens is diesel engines. So you have the cylinder, and during the combustion cycle, you have the include complete combustion, so you have soot precursors, then you have soot embryos and primary particle size, growth by coagulation and coalescence, and then you have agglomeration inside the cylinder. All these processes take place during the combustion and cobalt cycle, which takes about 3 to 4 milliseconds. So these are very fast processes.
Здесь показана схема шагов образования частиц из автомобильных двигателей. В результате работы двигателей часть неиспользованного топлива, она в результате за счет таких процессов, как коагуляция, рост, и образуются первичные высокодисперсные частицы, которые формируют далее цепочки агломератов, которые время жизни, образование которых 3-4 микросекунды. То есть очень достаточно быстро они образуются.
So then the exhaust is transported to the exhaust pipe, and this pipe is cooled from several hundred degrees, so 100 degrees centigrade. And then in the exhaust, you still have vapor that may condense, for example, hydrocarbons, they condense on the soot. And there can also be nucleation of, for example, sulfuric acid, depending on the availability of surface area. So you may have condensation of hydrocarbons.
Ну и образование гидрокарбонов и металлов в выхлопной трубе. Это тоже процесс 30 секунд, и образуется вот также первичные частицы.
So these are typical residence times or process times of 1 second, and then the exhaust is transmitted into the atmosphere.
И дальше все это выброс автомобильный попадает во внешнюю атмосферу. Там может подвергаться различным нейтрогенным химическим реакциям.
There you have restructuring eventually and heterogeneous chemical reactions involving these emissions.
И время жизни этих процессов от одного часа до одного дня.
So another industrial example for fine particle, ultra fine particle formation is silicium melting works. So there's melting of quartz sand in an induction surface, a furnace, and then you have emissions. And these emissions are primarily composed of silica fumes. Called silica fumes are actually silicium dioxide.
Ну здесь вот показана схема образования оксида силикона, результаты горения.
So these are is an uncontrolled way of formation of ultrafine particles, and as you can see here, the primary particle sizes can be as big as 100 nanometer or 0.1 nanometer, but also as small as a few nanometers. This actually depends on the history of the on the temperature history these particles have experienced. This is an uncontrolled process, so there are some particles which leave quickly the high temperature zone and so remain small.
Размер и форма образованного частиц бывает достаточно сложной, и она зависит от предыстории ее образования.
And of course, you have all these processes involved when you make engineered nanoparticles from high temperature processes, so there is a wide range of processes and from the aerosol phase, making engineered nanoparticles just by combining and steering and well controlling all these processes, nucleation and condensation and coagulation.
Здесь говорится о том, что есть устройства, в которых можно управлять процессом образования материалов в результате горения.
Okay, that means that for the anthropogenic ultrafine particles are primarily formed in high temperature processes by gas to particle conversion.
Антропогенные высокодисперсные частицы в первую очередь образуются при высокотемпературных процессах преобразования газов в частицы.
So let me show you one example how complex this can be and how surprisingly simple the explanation can be. Let us look at an exhaust plume of this high temperature process, like the diesel soot. And for the diesel soot, the soot was a problem, and therefore the governments reduced the emission standard or the emission level of diesel soot. And what the car manufacturers did, they put in a diesel filter into the exhaust pipe. This is this one here, diesel soot filter.
Здесь вот для уменьшения выбросов дизельной сажи, ну мы с вами знаем, китайские автобусы у нас, которые на остановках большие, вот используются дизельные, то есть
filter is placed very close to the engine because there are still high temperatures, and the burnout of the soup from time to time is easier at high temperatures as opposed to low temperatures. So the soot, the elementary soot, is very well captured and from time to time burned off.
И эти фильтры устанавливаются достаточно близко к двигателю, поэтому они работают при высокой температуре движения.
The filters are made of ceramic, porous.
И поэтому материал фильтров температурно устойчивый, керамический.
So, if you measure directly behind the soot filter, take a sample and dilute it properly and then measure the soot particle size distribution of this primary emission before the filter, then you get something like this. If you measure before the filter, this is the raw data. If you measure behind the filter, and you measure not directly behind the filter, but you measure at a diluted situation, so you measure under environmentally realistic conditions at sampling temperatures, let's say below 50 or 30 degrees.
Здесь приведены распределения частиц до фильтра и после фильтра.
And what you see, you get a significant reduction of the soot particles. So the black curve goes to the red part here. This is more than an order of magnitude, so the filter works excellent.
Здесь видно заметное уменьшение частиц ультравысокодисперсного
диапазона. But you get new particles, as you can see here. You get more particles behind the filter as before the filter.
Да, но появляется много новых частиц после фильтра.
So if you would have measured the filtration efficiency by just counting the particles, you would run into trouble. You would say, okay, it makes particles instead of reducing.
То есть если будете измерять, то обнаружите много частиц после диапазона.
And the reason is quite simple. So if you have no filter,
если у нас нет фильтра,
and if you would release your exhaust into the environment or into the cold environment, you would have the gaseous compounds condensed on the available surface area of the soot. Okay, this round is the hydrocarbons, they would condense heterogeneous condensation on the soot.
По сути, фильтр у нас в результате конденсации образуется вот такой сажевой частицы.
So, but when you have the filter, the soot particles are removed and you have much less surface area.
Если присутствие фильтра, конденсация заметно уменьшается.
And the condensable species then can undergo homogeneous nucleation, creating more particles.
И тогда в результате нуклеации в окружающей среде этих распыщенных частиц будет меньше. То есть
остается будет много, но размер будет меньше.
Да. Там, то есть не все конденсируется, потому что лавливается.
And this is actually really very well taken by the regulators. So they require when they test the filters that you measure in the size range that is not affected by the nucleation mode. So you measure, let's say, above 100 micro-nanometers is your instrument to characterize the filter. So this is a process that might happen with ultrafine particles, so that new ultrafine particles are generated. So it's actually can be a very complicated process, and you have to take care about, you have to understand the process before you draw any conclusion.
Поэтому в таком фильтре за счет нуклеации образуются много мелких частиц, и, конечно, процесс должен быть подробно изучен.
So when emitting ultrafine particles in the air, there may be the possibility that more ultrafine particles are formed in the exhaust plume or in the open air, and that they are subject to further transformation by chemical and physical processes.
И эти частицы могут быть образованы как в ближней области выхлопной трубы, так и в открытой атмосфере. И это объект дальнейшего преобразования в атмосфере через различные химические и физические процессы.
So, Yeah, this is actually quite easy. So the question is, what are the the dominating mechanisms of ultrafine particle motion in the air? And what I've noted here is nothing else than the traveling distance of a particle with the sizes described here for different times. For example, let's look at this curve, this one, and this one. That means how far does a particle go when it is released for 1 second. And as you can see, large particles is a blue curve, and ultrafine particles are the red curves. And so the mobility increases as the particle size increases.
Ну, здесь приведены расстояния, проходимые за единицу времени частицами за счет механизмов диффузии, охлаждения во всем диапазоне размеров частиц.
And this is also shown in the particle removal processes. So some people say that ultrafine particles are quickly removed from the atmosphere because of their high diffusion process, but actually this is not the case. So the deposition velocity is some indicator of the residence time in the atmosphere, and low deposition velocities means high residence time. And as you can see, the ultrafine particles here in this regime have already very low deposition velocities. So once they are emitted into the atmosphere, they have quite a long lifetime.
Здесь связанное с временем, с расстоянием проходимой отдельной частицы в воздухе, оно определяет и скорость возвращения частиц, и здесь вот кривые осаждения, скорости осаждения частиц, в зависимости от размера частиц, в области высокодисперсных частиц видно, что скорость осаждения весьма невысокая.
Yeah, so this is also reflected, this behavior that the diffusion increases with particle size is actually the explanation for the fact that when the particles get smaller, so more and more particles are deposited by diffusion in the various parts of the
spiral system.
So once emitted into the atmosphere, ultrafine particles are quite persistent, and they may end up in the atmosphere with residence times up to several days.
Вот эти частицы могут находиться в воздухе до нескольких дней, не осаждаться, не разлагаться.
But there are other processes that are affecting ultrafine particles. During the aging processes, this is coagulation, and coagulation is shown schematically here. That transforms fine particles, very fine particles, into larger particles. So this is these are distributions taken at two different times.
Здесь показано распределение частиц по размерам для двух моментов времени, когда из области ultrafine particles частицы вращаются за счет коагуляции.
So
сдвигаются в область проведения.
This coagulation is pretty well understood and can also be modeled. And you have quite a good understanding on what are the controlling parameters that determine coagulation. And this is, of course, the aging time and the mass concentration. So, if you look at the average particle diameter, you can see that when the mass concentration, CM, is increasing, the particles are growing, and also if the average, the aging time is increasing, the particles are growing as well.
Здесь приведена зависимость среднего размера частиц от концентрации и начальный размер частицы в результате роста частицы за счет коагуляции.
And the point is, in this picture, after a certain time, it's no difference what the initial particle size was. either 0.01 micrometers or 0.001 micrometers. At the very right side of this curve, you always end up with the same average diameter. So this is the property of the correlation process.
Здесь в результате видно, что в результате процесса конвергенции, неважно с какого начального размера частицы стартовал процесс, все равно вы выйдете на тот же самый средний диаметр.
So, for example, if we if you have 1 milligrams per cubic meter ultrafine particles in the air, and you have a resonance time of 10 seconds, then the particles are always larger than 10 nanometers. There is no way that the particles become smaller because they are always agglomerating into this particle size.
Ну вот на концентрацию 1 миллиграмм метр в процессе конвергенции выходит за 10 секунд, и средний диаметр в этом начинает быть больше 10 нанометров.
So if you have 1 milligrams and 1 hour as an other example, you end up already with let's say 150 nanometers in average particle size. So if you have this system, if you have 1 milligram per cubic meter, and you know that your residence time was 1 hour, then it's no way that you have particles that are smaller than 0.1 micrometers, because they must have agglomerated to this size.
Ну и здесь тоже через 1 час выход на концентрацию 1 миллиграмм на метр в кубе, и размер становится больше, чем доля микрометра.
And then there is another point, another physical point. This growth rate, so how far these particles grow, strongly depends also on the agglomerates. So agglomerates grow much faster than spheres, than coalescing spheres. And so the more fluffy the agglomerates are, so the more open, the faster they grow.
Скорость роста за счет конвергенции сильно зависит от формы частиц, и, конечно, для агломерантов она гораздо выше, чем для конвергирующих сфер.
So, coagulation is actually a sink for ultrafine particles, so they remove particles from the ultrafine particle size range, maybe to a larger particle size range, and this coagulation is very efficient.
Таким образом, коагуляция есть один из механизмов, основных источников появления в атмосфере высокодисперсных частиц.
So, let me go show you some examples of ultrafine particles that we have been measuring during the past decades. And one very interesting example of ultrafine particle assessment brought us to Norway, where they do a lot of aluminium smeltering because of the cheap electricity that they have. And so this is a typical smelter environment.
Вот на предприятии алюминиевого производства алюминия в Норвегии были проведены измерения этих высокодисперсных частиц.
And you see a whole bunch of so-called electrolytic cells, you know, that the melting is made by electrochemistry, and so from some to times they have to open these cells, and then of course fumes come out, and workers are exposed possibly to nanoparticles or to ultrafine particles.
Здесь плавление алюминия происходит за счет электрохимических процессов на этом производстве, и вот образуются наночастицы.
So what is taking place in the electrolytic separation cell? So you have a cathode and you have an anode. The anode is mainly made of carbon stuff. And yes, then you have your aluminium oxide material in the cell.
This is schema образования частиц алюминия. Из результате испарения из области между анодом и катодом.
But the aluminium oxide would not melt by itself because it has such a high melting temperature. temperature above 2000 degrees that cannot be maintained or established in the oven. Therefore, they add some fluorides, and this addition of the fluorides reduces significantly the melting temperature of the aluminium oxide, and then you get a liquid bath, and the aluminium, a dissociation takes place, and the aluminium is taken out by electric migration and is connected at the very bottom of this cell, and where it is released. And this is the metallic aluminium that you gain.
Это высокотемпературный процесс, я извиняюсь, я полностью не воспроизведу. Это высокотемпературный процесс, в результате алюминиевые частицы перемещаются внутри, внутри этой зоны и могут оседать на дно бассейна.
And if you open this, then of course you have the hot fumes coming out as you get fluorides, aluminium and sodium and electric carbon and also all kinds of very complicated emissions that are not yet very well understood. It's interesting to study them, and particularly to study the health effects. There are some health effects with the aluminium workers. They get so-called hot room asthma. And so then they have taken out of the production process and have to be replaced by other persons or have to
Множество различных сложных химических комплексов может появляться в результате этого процесса, которые сильно могут влиять на здоровье человека, в частности вызывать астму.
So we did some measurements, and so we put in some condensation nuclear counter, and we tried to get some information about the burden or the total concentration of the polluted workplaces. And there are two types of melting processes called Söderberg and Kriepel. This is a special name
of
cells, they pollute. These are two types of cathodes used.
Счетной концентрации частиц в результате исследования рабочей зоны для двух типов образования алюминия.
So we get concentrations up to, let's say, a few hundred thousand ultrafine particles per cc. And you see when you have a general site background, so the concentrations are of course or above the general site background, and then you have concentration in the Söderberg core, so where you use these Söderberg electrodes. You see this is already elevated substantially. It is not in the pre-made core, so using the other type of electrodes significantly reduces the concentration inside the core.
Ну, здесь различные для открытых и закрытых вещей, различные уровни концентрации для двух этих типов образования алюминия, производства алюминия.
But of course, when these cells are open for inspection, then of course you get a lot of high emissions and substantially increase
Ну, для обоих случаев при открытых этих в открытых ячейках концентрация безусловно намного выше.
So this is an example where so there is a crane at the ceiling and there is a person sitting inside a cabin. Controlling the crane, and we also could get some estimate on the efficiency of the air cleaning device that was built on the cabin. And as you can see here, the outside concentration is about 100,000 per cc, and inside the cabin it's significantly reduced, so the filtration works nicely. But when the crane comes into the areas where the nodes are changed, the crane actually does the node changing, that's put in the electrodes, then of course also the worker inside the crane experienced a high concentration or a higher concentration.
Ну, здесь приведена концентрация в кабине крана, в зоне производства алюминия снаружи и внутри кабины. И показана динамика в течение определенного времени и при изменении предлагаемого напряжения коммуна.
So with modern instrumentation you can easily follow these patterns and you can get a good information on the exposure of people working in these relatively harsh environments.
И такая концентрация должна влиять также на здоровье человека.
So this is now a long-term measurement, and we still have here a pattern that is being followed by instruments. This is again shows the significant level of exposure. The difference is the significant differences between the Sunaberg technology and the pre-bake. So by more and more introducing the pre-bake technology in the production process and replacing the old Sunaberg technology, one will be experiencing a lowering of the exposure concentration.
Здесь дается сравнение двух этих технологий производства алюминия и делается вывод, что вот вторая технология pre-bake, она более предпочтительна с точки зрения меньших концентраций алюминиевых аэрозолей в наружном помещении.
And the difference between Sunaberg and pre-bake is actually the unknown, which is in the pre-bake it's much more cleaner material that's being used. As opposed to the Sunaberg.
Вот различные материалы используются для мода в этих двух технологиях. Более подходящий материал для технологии пребы.
But of course it's more expensive.
Но это немножко дороже.
Yeah, so the number concentration which might be some indicator of good indicator of exposure. So we have substantial higher concentrations as outside, 500,000 cubics per centimeters cubed, and we have in the Sunaberg about 100,000, and in the pre-bake about 30,000 on average. And this is the room average, and means also some aging taking place. If you compare it with a polluted street canyon, then you are also in the range of 100,000 per cc candy.
Ну, в итоге оценки силовой концентрации показывают, что вот первой технологии концентрации частиц близка к концентрации частиц в уличном каньоне.
So, but this is also only the total number concentration, and we wanted also to learn something about the aerosol aging by coagulation or whatever, whether we could see what is theoretically expected, do we see this also at the workplace? And therefore, we also use this electrical mobility classifier, which I introduced in the first lecture, and measured the size distribution. And so the mean one is what we measure close to the surface when they are open. So there is an overwhelming contribution of the very, very fine particles. Most of the particles are lying below the detection limit of the instrument. Therefore, we have this kind of strange curve which goes not down on the other side, because we cannot measure anymore in this range. It's not protection. So these are the primary, the fresh emissions.
Здесь вот выбросы, оценка распределения частиц по размеру показывает, что больше число частиц, то есть число частиц меньше 10 нанометров не было изменено, а больше число частиц мы показываем на этой слайде.
So, if we go further away and allow some aging, you see other modes showing up. And these are related to a coagulation, so they are developing from the primary emissions.
Ну и вот в результате концентрация уменьшается, синие линии показывают в результате коагуляционного процесса. Это измерение дальше не сразу на выходе из процесса.
And even if you wait even longer, then the nucleation mode of these spine particle mode completely disappeared, and the aerosol mass is mainly completely transformed into these particle sizes.
Еще через большее время за счет коагуляции и нуклеации вот кривая распределение принимает такой вид.
So the actual exposure of the person really depends on where he actually is, and so if he is close to the sun, then he will experience a large number of nanoparticles, but if he's walking around in the hall, where you have, of course, on the average long residence times, he will see something like this.
Влияние на человека при этом будет зависеть, насколько близко он находится в зоне производства алюминия или дальше в какой зоне. Соответствующее осаждение внутри дыхательных путей.
So this is a diagram of the size distribution and how it is in the hall. So we placed in the hall the instrument, and here we have the time. So you see it's several hundred minutes, so it's several hours, and on this scale you have the mobility diameter, and at the vertical scale you have the concentration. And as you can see here, we always have this bimodal distribution. So we have a sequence of releases in fine particles, or if you look at the color plot, these are the green shaded areas. So we have intermittent release of fine particles, very fine particles, and then they are growing to larger particles by coagulation. So this process can be understood and can also be very well described theoretically by combining aerosol coagulation and ventilation in the room.
Здесь показаны результаты измерения вот распределения частиц по размеру для технологии Prepaid по времени, зависимости и по диаметру. Ну и тут тоже на этих рисунках наблюдается рост размера частиц в результате процесса коагуляции, который может быть теоретически предварительно прогнозирован.
So there is a high dynamics involved in these aerosols.
Ну, видно здесь сильная динамика аэрозоля.
So in the Söderberg, the primary emissions are much lower, and also the average pollution is much higher. And here you don't see these effects of the primary emissions. Of course, also the system is open. But the reason is that we do not see these primary emissions is that the overall pollution is much higher in Söderberg, and the primary emissions coming from the opening cells are immediately collected by the other particles that are already present. Therefore, in the Söderberg environment, we do only see one mode, almost only one mode in the solid spectrum.
Ну, здесь видна картина для другой технологии, когда используются открытые камеры. Ну, распределение отличается.
So, what does this say? I already mentioned, but we can really see this also in the real industrial environment, that that the size distribution is typical that we measure for gas and particle conversion processes. So nucleation and growth by coagulation and condensation.
Типичное распределение для данных экспериментов наблюдается типичное распределение для функции распределения размера образуемого в результате перехода от газа к частице за счет процессов нуклеации, а также роста за счет коагуляции и конденсации.
And what we also have clearly seen, and which is very interesting, is that when the overall environment is cleaner, then the nucleation mode is more persistent because the scattering surface is lower indeed.
В чистой окружающей среде нуклеационная мода более устойчива, связанная с меньшей поверхностью с меньшей рассеянной поверхностью.
The major sources for these nucleation mode particles are, of course, the evaporation of materials from the hot baths of the cells.
Основным источником частиц в области nucleation mode испарение материала из обоих бассейнов.
So this is very complicated, or you can at least understand it. What we have not understood is the diversity of the structures that we found in this environment. So these are all pictures, and this will show you at the end of my presentation. And so where all these different structures coming from? You have all structures that you may find in industrial hygiene at one place. So what we did is we sampled the air and had kind of deposition, thermophoretic deposition on electron microscopic grids. So we did no kind of sample preparation. We just took the grids and put it into the transmission electron microscope. So there's no sample preparation. So all what you see is what you see in reality. And so you can see here some fibers, which are definitely not asbestos fibers or stuff like this. I assume that the crystallites have grown into one dimension. Then you see agglomerates. There are agglomerates coming from the soot, which is in the anodes, in the cell material. And then we see other particles. We see particles with a corona around them.
Ну, здесь видны снимки без предварительной подготовки проб отбора в микроскопе образованных частиц. Ну, видны агломераты, волокнистые частицы, вот так упомянутые производства.
So here are more examples. Upper left is the typical soot agglomerate. And then we get here some crystals.
Кристаллизованные частицы, имеющие правильный форму.
All kind of different particles, and there is a cooperation with a German university in Darmstadt and the Norwegian Industrial Hygiene Institute, with whom we have carried out this study together, and they have had a closer look at these particles, getting something about the elemental composition. But I cannot import the data now because I don't have it. So you see there is a wide range of different particles here. And you see many of them are really ultrafine or are made of ultrafine particles. So there is still some room for scientific activity to understand these very complicated processes. I think we are a few minutes ahead, but
требуется дополнительные научные исследования для того, чтобы понять морфологию и размеры образованных частиц. есть небольшое время для вопросов. Прошу извинения, местами мой перевод был, конечно, далек от идеального. Я думаю, что кто поднимет, но, наверное, кто может читать. Это ближе к концу. Так, есть вопросы? Да, какие вопросы у вас? Все верят, все верят. У вас, ребята, какие вопросы есть? По двум лекциям, может быть. Have you any questions? How are you doing? Все, готов.